Welcome back to your free Active Directory training course. This video will look at the placement for Operation Master roles and global catalog servers in your organization. First of all, I will look at Operational Master role placement. When you install your first domain controller in your first forest, all the Operational Master roles are going to be on this server. Also, the first domain controller in the domain is automatically made a global catalog server. On any reasonably sized network, it is more than likely there will be more than one domain controller in the network for redundancy. Without a second domain controller, if the first domain controller were to fail, then no one would be able to log on to the network. Unless moved by an administrator, notice that when the second domain controller was added to the network, the Operation Master role stayed on the first domain controller. See the previous video on how to move Operation Master roles from domain controller to domain controller. There are a lot of reasons why Operation Master roles are moved around the network. First, there's availability. Having Operation Master roles on different domain controllers means that if the server were to become unavailable, only the roles on that server would become unavailable. This is basically not putting all your eggs in one basket. When choosing which domain controllers to put which Operation Master roles on, you should also consider how much load the server is going to be put under. Some Operation Master roles put more load on the server than others. If you have a busy server that handles a lot of authentication requests, it may be best to put the Operational Master role on a domain controller that is used less. First off, let's have a look at the forest-wide Operation Master roles, the Schema and Domain Naming Master roles. The forest-wide Operation Master roles, Schema and Domain Naming Master, don't get used that often. It's not that they are not important. It is just that if these roles become unavailable, you would no longer be able to add domains or change the schema. On some networks, these two roles could be offline indefinitely if the schema was never changed or domains added or removed. If these roles are not available for a long time, you will get error messages in the event log that these roles are not available, but this will not stop your network from running. Even on a large network, it is doubtful that schema change or domain name change activities happen very often. For this reason, to make these roles easy to administer, you can put both these roles on the same server. Since the Domain Naming Master will contact the Global Catalog server when adding domains, it is a good idea to make the domain controller that is holding these roles a Global Catalog, although it is not necessary. The other forest-wide role is the Schema Master role, which does not require a Global Catalog server. For this reason, the Schema Master can be put on any domain controller in your enterprise. In a multiple domain environment, even though not required, most administrators will place the Schema and Domain Name Master on a domain controller in the root domain of the forest. Since the schema and domain naming affect the whole forest, it makes sense to keep these roles in the root domain. The root domain will be the last domain to be removed if you change your domain namespace, so placing forest-wide roles in the root space makes sense. That's the two forest-wide roles covered. Now for the domain-wide roles, PDC Emulator, Infrastructure, and RIDMaster. When deciding where to put the PDC Emulator, you should consider putting the role on the network that has the most users. This is because the PDC Emulator is the final authority on password-based requests, and thus it makes sense to put it on the network that has the most authentication requests on it. It does not matter if the PDC Emulator is a global catalog server or not. On a very busy domain controller holding the PDC Emulator, administrators may remove the global catalog from the domain controller in order to reduce the load. If there are no performance problems on your domain controller, it does not hurt to make the domain controller a global catalog server. Next, you have the RIDMaster. The RIDMaster allocates blocks of RIDs and thus does not have to be on the fastest link or the fastest server. Don't get me wrong, all Operation Master roles are important, so you should always do your best to run any domain controller on reliable hardware. On a domain with very few objects being created, the RID master could be unavailable at times and no one would notice. If you have a domain where a lot of objects are being created, or you run a job which creates a lot of Active Directory objects, the RID master becomes very important, and it being down for a period of time will cause certain operations to fail. The PDC emulator generally uses more RIDs than other domain controllers. For this reason, administrators often will put the RID master on the same domain controller as the PDC emulator, although this is not required. Once again, like the PDC emulator, the RID operation role is not affected if the domain controller is or is not a global catalog server. The next role is the infrastructure master role. This is used to keep references between different domains up to date. If there is only one forest and one domain, the placement of the infrastructure master role is not that important, since you won't have any cross-domain objects to keep track of. You can make this domain controller a global catalog server, or leave it as just a domain controller in a single domain environment. When you have a multi-domain environment, the infrastructure master role becomes more important, since there are multi-domain objects to keep track of. If you make the domain controller holding the infrastructure master role a global catalog server, problems can occur. The problem occurs when the infrastructure master attempts to update a cross-domain object. When the infrastructure master is a global catalog server, it consults the global catalog server to see if the object is up to date. The global catalog is always up to date, so the infrastructure master thinks nothing needs to happen, which is when the problem comes in. The role of the infrastructure master is to identify cross-domain reference changes and inform other servers on the network about these changes. When the infrastructure master role is on a global catalog server, this may not occur. This is because it consults the global catalog server, which may already have the change in it. The infrastructure master thinks the change has already been made and ignores the change, not telling any other servers about the change. The simplest way to fix this is to make all your domain controllers on the network global catalog servers. By default, Windows Server 2008 will make all new domain controllers global catalog servers. If you cannot make all domain controllers into global catalog servers, simply ensure the infrastructure master is not a global catalog server. This will ensure that it always communicates any reference problems it finds to other domain controllers. For ease of administration, it is easiest to ensure that all domain controllers are global catalog servers. This won't affect any operation in the forest, but it does have some drawbacks. Making all domain controllers global catalog servers does require more bandwidth and hard disk space. Nowadays, networks are faster than they used to be when Windows Server 2000 came out, so this may not be a problem. If you do not want to make all your domain controllers global catalog servers, then simply make sure your infrastructure master is not a global catalog server. Once this is done, you are free to select or deselect any domain controller to be or not to be a global catalog server. If you decide not to make all your domain controllers global catalog servers, then you should give some thought to the placement of your global catalog servers. Applications such as Exchange make a lot of use of global catalog servers. If the Exchange server has to go over a wide area network to reach a global catalog server, this may affect performance. For this reason, if you are using Exchange or a product like Exchange that makes a lot of calls to a global catalog server, you should have a global catalog server on your local network. Microsoft recommends global catalog placement if you have over 100 users in the one location or a location that has a lot of roaming users. The reason roaming users require a global catalog is when a roaming user logs onto a network from remote, the global catalog server needs to be contacted. Global catalog servers are used to determine membership when users are in universal groups. Universal groups are simply groups that can have users from multiple domains in them. Without access to a global catalog server, Universal Group membership cannot be worked out, and thus the user may not be able to log in. Covered in a later video, I look at a feature called Universal Group Caching. This allows previous Universal Group lookups to be cached on a domain controller to improve later performance. Now that you understand about global catalog placement, let's go to a Windows Server 2008 domain controller and look at how to make it, or stop it from being, a global catalog server. First of all, open Active Directory User and Computers from the Start menu. From Active Directory Users and Computers, expand down until you get to Domain Controllers. This will show all the computer accounts for all the domain controllers in the domain. To get to the Global Catalog settings, right-click the Domain Controller computer account that you want to change and open its properties. From here, select the button at the bottom, NTDS Settings. Once you have the NTDS settings open, tick or untick the tick box Global Catalog. That's it. Close all the dialog boxes and Windows will handle the rest. You should now have a good understanding of which domain controllers to make global catalog servers and which domain controllers you should select to hold which roles. But what happens when the domain controller holding one of these roles is no longer available? A very bad hardware crash could cause the domain controller that is holding an operation master role to never be available to be booted up again. So what do you do when this occurs? In the next video, I will look at just that. Seizing operation master roles when the domain controller holding that role is no longer available. Thanks for watching this free video, and please feel free to check out our other free videos from our other free courses. See you next time.